Welcome to Sicily, the southernmost region of Italy. A place that's so unique and so different from the rest of the country. It often feels like a country of its own, which for most of its history, it actually was. In this series, I'm joining Trafalgar's Colors of Sicily tour. Well, I'll be traveling along the coastline to take in the Mediterranean island's natural wonders and spectacular views. I'll visit Sicily's colorful markets and traditional eateries to taste its world-famous cuisine, and visit its many World Heritage sites to bask in one of humanity's oldest and most fascinating cultures. I'll travel overland from the capital Palermo, with trips to scenic seaside towns and mountaintop villages in the north, then follow the coast southwards to the ancient vineyards of Marsala and the rich farmlands of Agrigento. I'll stop by Sicily's best-kept secrets, the breathtaking Baroque towns of Ragusa and Modica, with a side trip to the island's highest and most dangerous point, Mount Etna, before ending my grand tour in the elegant cities of Siracusa and Taormina on the Ionian Sea, where famous writers and novelists celebrated the wonders of Sicily centuries before me. So join us, I'm David Celdran in Sicily, and this is Executive Class. Welcome to Palermo, the capital of Sicily, Italy's southernmost island, and in many ways its least Italian. Located in the middle of the Mediterranean and blessed with a natural harbor, a gentle climate, and fertile soil, Sicily and Palermo, its major city, was conquered repeatedly, and the island a colony for most of its history. Indeed, in the colorful and chaotic streets of Palermo, it's sometimes hard to tell if you're in North Africa or southern Spain. Even the locals here look a bit different and speak a language that's unlike Italian. That's Palermo, a city where the great cultures of the Mediterranean collide. Vestiges of its colonial past remain visible in its domed skyline and on its historic streets.
This is beautiful. It's a Baroque beauty. This is the Quattro Canti, and where I'm standing right now, at the center of it, is literally the center of the old town of Palermo. It's also the best place to start your walking tour of the major sites of the city, because they're all walkable from here. In fact, you can see quite a number just from where I'm standing, including these beautiful Baroque buildings.
On a Saturday, the Quattro Canti at the intersection of Palermo's four busiest quarters is among the best spots to watch locals enjoy their cherished passeggiata tradition. That leisurely stroll doing, well, nothing really. But for a traveler, the view is amazing. Four curvilinear corners of breathtaking Baroque beauty. The Spanish were the last to rule over Sicily, and part of their legacy was the lavish Baroque architecture they built in their royal city. Luckily, the piazza is pedestrianized, so take time to marvel at the details and sculptures of the four seasons, the Spanish monarchs, and the female patron saints that adorn three tiers of each perfectly symmetrical corner structure. I'm told travelers who visited more than a decade ago wouldn't recognize this part of the city today. What was once a gritty, even dodgy part of town has been revitalized since. Indeed, I've heard many stories about how dangerous and dirty Palermo is, and I'm surprised that it seems pretty safe and clean. And once you rid your mind of images of mafiosi, thieves, and scammers lurking in dark streets, that's when Palermo begins to enchant you, with its architectural legacy especially.
It's so fascinating to see how so many layers of history come together in a single city like Palermo. You have Greek, Roman, Carthaginian, Arab, Byzantine, Norman, French, Spanish, and of course Italian.
One good place to view this is the Piazza Bellini, where three of the city's most important churches and theater face each other. Travel back in time with the Norman-era church of Santa Maria del Ammiraglio, built during the age when Norman kings ruled Sicily from Palermo.
though the Byzantine dome and the mosaics inside reflect the Greek Orthodox Christian heritage of the island when it was still a colony of the Byzantine Empire before the Arab conquest of Sicily. A Baroque facade was added during the Spanish period many centuries later. Palermo was also the seat of the Arab Emirate of Sicily. The Church of San Cataldo next door, with its three red domes, is one of the best examples of the unique Arab-Norman architectural style that flourished. Across the square is the Chiesa di Santa Caterina di Alessandria, a Spanish-era Baroque masterpiece with a brightly colored tile dome that dominates the skyline. A short walk from the square leads you to one of Palermo's most famous and divisive landmarks, the Piazza Pretoria.
It's just amazing. There's something around every corner of the city.
Built in Florence in the 16th century, a huge fountain was shipped all the way here to provide Palermo with a grand monument befitting a royal city. Adorned with 16 nude figures in central pose, devout Catholics have since called it the Fountain of Shame. Much of Palermo's greatest hits are in the vicinity, but just in case you make a wrong turn somewhere, don't worry.
I guess there are two faces of Palermo. You have just a few hundred meters away, the touristy side, and in the side streets of the middle of the city, this, an authentic part of Palermo, which is starkly different from what you see in the guidebooks and magazines.
Some still call this Palermo's slums. Historic buildings, even a few aristocratic palazzos, since overrun by poor families and immigrants after the area was destroyed by heavy Allied bombing.
And yet, there's something that's beautiful about how everything seems so run down. Not to romanticize poverty, but this is what I've always imagined Palermo to be like.
Indeed, it's this mix of classes and local and immigrant communities that make Palermo vibrant and alive. A real living city, not an outdoor museum for tourists, like so many you now find across Italy.